My name is Michiel Hamers. I'm 45 years old. I'm solution lead and Microsoft Azure MVP. And fun fact, I have a favorite Azure service. That's Logic Apps. That is due to the fact that you can easily try out new things in Azure, and I really like that. I'm from the Netherlands, as you can hear on my English accent, and I work I work for the company. It's called Soprasteria. Who knows Soprasteria? Oh, that makes it more people. I used to work for Ordina Netherlands, and we did it really good, right?
Yeah, so we were bought last year.
So
I think more people here know Soprasteria than at Ordina when we got the news that we had a new owner. But
hey, that will be a great opportunity to give more talks and educate more people about the cloud. Next up.
Yeah, so my name is Twan Coat. I'm 31 years old. I'm also in the Azure space within my company. It's principal expert, but my job is giving presentations and helping customers do the right things on the cloud or fixing their flaws on the cloud. Usually the latter, so I'm more of the cleanup guy after somebody has installed everything to the portal and then fun and games for me. My favorite Azure service is App Service because I do like Kubernetes, but the talk before this mentioned, do you really need Kubernetes? And that's the first thing I ask to development teams when they start saying, ah, we need Kubernetes, and do you really need it? And then they usually end up with App Service. But
yeah, but it's cool and shiny, and everyone is using it, yeah. Right?
So what are we going to talk about today? I don't know if we invent this Venn diagram, but we use it to describe three circles of areas of good cloud design. It's all about architecture. It's about continuous improvement. Wouldn't you know in 24. And it's all about team. It's about the engineers running your cloud environment. Without proper engineers, you're still going to end up with a shitty experience. That's our...
Really, in 5 minutes, the whole presentation?
Yeah.
A summary of the whole presentation in 5 minutes. That's all.
So now we're going to deep dive this stuff.
So let's first part zoom in on the architecture part. And I know all PowerPoint gimmicks in it, but yeah, we don't have that much great of PowerPoint skills. So if after the sessions you have questions or remarks on the content, but also nice tips on PowerPoint, just shout or say it quietly. This, you can improve this and you can improve that. We really love tips.
Yeah. So. When we use, this is an example, especially for the public cloud vendors like Azure, Google, Amazon, we say geo-efficiency. And the fun thing, especially in Azure, is not every region is the same. You might think when I order something of Azure, I pay the same amount of money. Or on each region, that's not the case. So that's something fun you could use to, and I'm going to show you an example because this is all fun. So let's assume you want a VM, something from Azure, because I'm Azure MVP. A D16 is a 16-core VM with 64 gigs of RAM. We use Ubuntu to stay away from Windows because we don't want to pay any licensing fee. These are the different prices for the same service across Azure.
Same services, right? Same.
Same, like nothing different. Just the region is different. So, anybody from Brazil? I hope not, because you already see a huge difference. I can't pinpoint how Microsoft, in case Microsoft, came up with the pricing. It shouldn't be based around energy prices, because the energy prices in the Netherlands, West Europe, are crazy high, mm-hmm. But West Europe is kind of cheap if you compare them to Switzerland or Brazil.
Yeah, and West Europe is from Microsoft perspective in the Netherlands, and North Europe is Ireland.
Yeah. So what can you learn about this is when you start deploying on the cloud, check which region do I need? Do I need blazingly fast latency? Then you should deploy in the closest region available to you. Are you looking for the most value for money? Then open the portal and start clicking around the different regions. There are websites who are scraping the API of Azure to provide a graph which...
Yeah, but that if you rely on that one and that it has caching on it or old info, always trust yourself and your own observations and your own tests.
But are there people in the room deliberately deploying services into a different region based on the price? One. Yes. For me, I deploy all my test environments to North Europe because that's cheaper.
Yeah. Roughly said, for this example, 8%.
8% difference. And the latency difference is like 10 milliseconds. So I really don't care for development or test that it's a little bit slower. There's already something you can do to save a lot of money. Michiel, you've came up with CMEC, so you can explain that.
Yeah, a cloud major expenditure categories, it's to ensure that you can categorize all costs, for example, the compute resources, the long-term commitments. You can, therefore, all, if you know what kind of cost do you have, and where you have, for example, cost of ingress, the data center in, the data center out, software licensing. If you know which part of your bill is using what, and you categorize that with this list, then you can still, you have to work something, but you can have some insights and make smarter decisions. Because, there is always the magic story of everyone. If you move it to the cloud, it is cheaper, right? That's the basic understanding, or at least the commercial marketing story. But if you have insights, what part of your bill is really ensuring that the bill is really big, then you can focus on that one just by classifying and getting insights. And for example, that software licensing, we already touched base on that, choosing Windows or Linux. If you are a developer and you are running .NET code, which can be run on a lot of different environments, you don't need a Windows hosted backend if it just can run that .NET framework in Linux. It really makes the difference of license costs. So categorize, ensure that you have insights, that really helps. But if you have some insights and you categorize that, then you should also go for some budgeting.
Yeah. So, what we see in major companies where we do consultancy, they tend to have a budget for their cloud expenses. That budget tends to be fixed. Or I see the first one that's a free-for-all, there's no budget, and they usually end up with the complaint, it's too expensive. Who here has a budget for their infrastructure?
Yeah.
Is it a fixed budget? Yes. Do I like fixed budgets? No, I like them because I'm gonna explain a joke next to it. But for me, I'm more interested in a variable budget and a metric-based budget for your cloud expenditure. I'm going to explain why.
Yeah, but maybe one trick. Is what? It clear what is a difference between fixed budgets and variable budgets?
Seems clear. Not
anyone who dare to say, I understand that difference a bit?
I saw an explanation needed. So a fixed budget is, let's say I get 1,000 euros a month to spend on the cloud. And a variable budget would be in December with the holidays, you get 1,400 instead of the 1,000. And a metric base is based on maybe cost per user, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So with a fixed budget or a static budget, it's really easy to stay within the budget. Because just saying $1 or 1 euro below that, and you're below the budget. And there isn't any incentive to improve beyond that from a cost perspective. Because you hit the budget, that's fine. That's what we usually see with fixed budget, is that the team lowers the cost to the budget and says, well, now we're done. The manager is happy because the budget is being hit. But there's lots of room for improvement. And if you look at the cloud, it's elastic. So let's assume Black Friday.
Everyone knows Black Friday, right? Yep. Concept of Black Friday. Yep.
You know, so in order to run the Black Friday, you need more infrastructure, maybe some load balancers, infinite pods or nodes. You're going to be over budget that month because you're scaling up for that huge spike in usage. But if you look at it from a business perspective, that's probably your most lucrative month of the year, Black Friday. Huge sales, huge revenue. So is it really that bad that you went over budget that month?
I think on the month of Black Friday, and then you can, and you have a fixed budget, and the service will shut down just during that Black Friday day. I think you have also a discussion. Maybe it's better to have a discussion about going over the budget instead of limiting it.
So next interaction with the audience. So I dare to say everyone's cloud environment contains waste.
Yeah, but
the only question is how much waste.
Yeah, and what is waste in this case, and how you can see it? You can see it, yeah?
Yeah, so I have a very nice graph over here. It's the CPU metric from a VM. When I look at this, I'm getting really depressed. When our system engineers look at this, they are really happy because we have low usage. I only see unused capacity, which we do pay for. Another example, when I ask my company, okay, I need a new MacBook, and they said, I need some more memory to have all those Docker containers and all those Kubernetes engines running. They said, yeah, that's fine, but you get a 1 terabyte drive with that. And I'm like, I don't need that because I have one drive and I store all my files online. This is also waste because they paid, I don't know, Apple prices, so 300 euros for the 1 terabyte drive, which I don't use. So it's not all about CPU memory, it's also about disks. And to put a bit more in perspective to understand what we mean by cloud waste is this.
Yeah, and you can see it in a simple graph, but then it's clear with as IT guys, it's sometimes to have really figures in something that you can say, okay, it is now better or worse than last month or last year, and therefore you need to calculate something.
Yeah, so we talked about metric-based budgets and something to calculate waste. And please say if it's, we need to explain it more. I have a performance test background. For me, this is really a no-brainer. I'm going to explain some more. Mm-hmm. If you take your amount of users you have, like, on average on your system, you can also calculate the maximum users you could provide. So let's say you have a system, you're able to host tens of thousands of users a month, but you're only hosting 10. You have so much unwasted capacity on the system. And a small example for that is, let's say you can run 1,000 users on your system during an hour, but you're only running 100. You have 90% waste at that moment. So you can calculate this during over a minute, over an hour, a day, a month, a year.
And you should calculate it, and you should discuss what is acceptable. And I know that that sounds not logical to have that totally at the level of all the people who are creating stuff like developers do. But still, if we don't create that discussion based on some facts and interpretation, then it will just end up with a simple budget. That's the budget that the manager is going to say without any technology or driven or facts, or then it will be a really silly discussion, right? So, yeah, if we can calculate it, we can also reduce the waste.
Yeah. So the easiest one and the best one is to improve code efficiency. The more efficient your code, the smaller system you need, or the smaller container you need, so the better.
Yeah. And I see over here the picking the right SKU is really important. Auto scaling, a no-brainer. Stacking is maybe an thing that can be explained. If you are using an Azure, you can combine several services to ensure that you optimize the part what you already paid for. You had a more nice example
so
for that one.
Let's assume you have a cluster, and our stacking means putting as much applications on that cluster as possible. So what I typically see, we spin up a cluster for just one application. That's not that efficient, so let's put on 10 applications on that cluster. So you share the hardware even more. So that's stacking.
I skipped one.
Yeah.
On purpose. That's the reducing zero user cost. You can already think of what is zero user cost and how do you reduce it. And later on the presentation, we come back to that one. For now, first, the two cost models, CapEx and OpEx. Everyone, now, is there someone who needs some additional explanation? What is CapEx or OpEx? Awesome. Because we based on, yep. Yeah, let's just go back. Yep. Let me explain it a bit myself. Capital expense, that's the abbreviation of CapEx. Capital based is for really that you invest an X amount of money. For example, you're buying a server and you place it in your own on-prem data center. That's capital-based expense, and on that way you can have compute power, ensure that he does nice compute power things in your server with a single thing that you buy. So, for example, you invest 10,000 euros, that's a CapEx cost model, it's not based on the operation itself, investment-based. While OpEx,
it's only operation, so the amount of money you spend on operating or keeping it alive in the cloud. Cloud providers tend to work on OpEx. They can do on CapEx, so you can say, I want to invest €1 million this year. You get a little bit of discount. But in general, it's all OpEx. And that's something different from doing it, you're hosting your own data center.
Yeah, and some people say, yeah, but you cannot really CapEx in the cloud.
Yeah. You could use reservations, and that's a sort of CapEx in the cloud.
Yeah, that's one of the ways. The other way that is pretty known is SAP for HANA. When you have SAP for HANA, you can really buy data racks. You buy the data racks. They will place it in the Azure environment. And then you consume it just like all the other Azure consumption-based OpEx things. Yeah?
Where does committed use discount fit in? So if I say I have guarantee that I'm going to use like 1,000 instances X for 3 years, that's kind of a guaranteed thing. It is kind of flow variable, so I think of it as OpEx, but I don't know since it's committed spend if that gets considered CapEx. Maybe I should
I think at that point it gets to the definition part of discussion, and for the Microsoft Azure way, I'm not sure for the AWS part of, but for the Microsoft way, there is you do the commitment for the compute power on your bill, so it doesn't really matter. At the same time, the compute power on your bill is for the SAP for HANA part. Eh? If you buy the whole data center racks that Microsoft will shift to the Azure environment, then that part is already paid on the CapEx part. But all the rest of the things are OPEX. So, yeah, definition. On the hand, on the back, there's a question. Yes? Yes? Oh, yeah. Yeah, maybe a good disclaimer also for the recording. The definitions that we use for CapEx and OPEX explanation is not for taxing or lawyers, or it's giving insight in this room what the general idea behind CapEx and OPEX is, operational or based on the investment, as a general idea and not the real definition and tax parts. Yep.
Good disclaimer.
Yeah, good disclaimer. Yep. Yep. Yeah, so if I hear it correct, and also for checking that everyone can understand the same, capital is, so to say, a CapEx is like, in from financial perspective, that it will become your asset, and then it has tax rules and regulations on that one, and therefore treated different in the rest of your administration, right?
It's not a consumption.
Yep, it's not a consumption. Yep. But as from that point of view, there is some strange thing on the cloud-based cost model CapEx. That example that we use for SAP for HANA, you buy a complete data center rack with really compute power, and you probably will never, ever, 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 ever see that rack with your own eyes. Because Microsoft will place it in the Microsoft Azure environment, and it is not allowed, and that's for all the things that are in the Azure data center, it's not allowed to be reused after using in the Azure data center, so it will be demolished afterwards. So from that point of view, I think that's really good to have that into...
I'm gonna skip some...
Yeah, no. Correctly, because we already discussed that part. Cool.
Now we're here. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome.
I need to tame him down a little bit for time purposes. So if you see him, I'm shutting him down. It's fine. He knows.
I know.
I know.
And,
so,
and we know that's the end of the day, and we know. But it's also fun. Yeah.
So the next part is more about continuous improvement. It's a little bit loosely. So we're going to explain something, I think, old school. I'm 31 years old, and JIT...
That's not old school.
For me, it's really old, yeah. But everybody familiar with the term just in time from Lean or black belts in the room? I think if you want to properly introduce cloud, you need to do... just-in-time clouds, pretty different, but there's a reason why Toyota became like really good at Lean, and because it works. And when we look at cloud architectures, I think it's similar. And by using the same principles, I think you get a more lean cloud and therefore a cheaper cloud. So if we look at, this is all stolen from the internet, Wikipedia, I believe.
Yeah, this part, right?
Yeah, this part.
Okay.
In 1999, Speer and Brown identified 4 rules for the lean DNA of Toyota. All work should be highly specified to content, sequence, timing, and outcome. Second one, every supplier and consumer, or consumer and supplier, is direct. Mm-hmm. So no big warehouses and that sort of stuff. There's a pathway for every product, and service must be simple and direct. You're already starting to see some patterns in the cloud. And any improvement must be made in accordance with a scientific method, like the lean or Sigma.
Yeah.
Now,
so
last year, we swiped away Toyota's and we said cloud's lean DNA. And we just altered a couple of words within the same example. And so we said, all infrastructure shall be highly specified as to content, sequence, timing, and outcome.
Mm-hmm.
An example, do you really need this new VM, or can it be on the one you already have? And something I like to do is like doing a ping system. So I see a lot of services running. I don't know to who uses those VMs or clusters. I just pull the plug and then somebody complains. Then I know, okay, that's something we needed. But there are also systems, I just pull the plug and nobody complains. I'm like, why is that there? That isn't following that it's specified to an outcome or content.
Yep, that's a principle.
The second one, every request or response must be direct, yes or no. So no silly load balancing, application gateway, event bunch nonsense, what I see.
Mm-hmm.
And the third one, Michiel, can you tell me that?
The prediction for every product and service must be simple and direct. So no special things need to be arranged. It's simple and direct.
Simple, don't build monoliths in the cloud. If you want to do that, fine, but be prepared that you are spending too much money on that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason you have cloud native development. It's usually microservice architecture. And the fourth one is it's a bit tricky because I underlined scientific method, because there isn't a scientific method in the cloud.
But sometimes it's already scientific or more scientific than it used to be by having it documented and agreed upon at your own company.
Yeah. When the cloud made its way to our environment, our workplace, it was pretty fun for the big companies because they said, oh, then we can just boot out all the system engineers, boot out all the network engineers because, oh, that does the cloud. No. If you want to do anything improvement, you need cloud engineers or network engineers. So not to bash on developers, but those are really good at writing code, but sometimes not so good in implementing proper cloud infrastructure. So any improvement must be made in accordance with an architecture board consists of cloud engineers,
mm-hmm.
if you ask me.
Definitely. When you compare lean manufacturing with defects and waiting and that kind of things with lean cloud, you have really more or less the same, and therefore a real nice overview where you should where you put your focus on.
Yeah, so if you want to compare again, I compare lean manufacturing against lean cloud, the first column on the left, just pulled straight from the Lean Six Sigma website. If you translate that to cloud, you get optimized quality. So don't put untested code in production, inefficient code. Keep your application simple.
Mm-hmm.
That's if you compare that to excesses processing, waiting and waiting should be happening. And the last one is really important, non-utilized talent.
Yep.
I think the best systems are being built by really smart engineers. So it's the same.
By the way, if we move too fast with one of the slides and you want to look back at it afterwards, or you didn't get the moment to grab a picture of, at the last slide we have a QR code which you can scan, contact us, and then you get slides. How to improve? Yeah, four principles that you at least take to into account. Automate. Did I already mention? Everything in the cloud you should automate. It's pretty simple, but we've seen at a lot of customers, a lot of clients, that they do, it's not called DevOps, but...
Yeah, we call it ClickOps.
ClickOps. Just opening the portal, add new network interface or whatsoever. It happens in 2024.
Yeah, so the issue with that is that deploying new servers is fine, but when you do ClickOps, they never get shut down.
Always use also the cloud first focus. If you have on-prem, shift the whole management to the cloud first approach and take some time for that. If you have a cloud first idea in the manager's mind, that makes it also also an easier discussion later on, okay, we need to move that to the cloud, or I need learning for the cloud. Really create some time for yourself to at least convince that cloud first is really the strategy to go on. Cloud native architecture, that comes along with that. And maybe the most important one if you do it well, or the not important one if you are not going doing it well, because monitoring is really waste of time if you don't follow up any of those actions.
Well,
because the cross-section I asked in the back of my mind is design patterns. Because if you go cloud wrong and you don't have design patterns, like ClickOps, then you're going to be suffering.
And then you end up with a cloud environment which is a wrong implementation of your on-prem environment because they are not the same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then there's the Phoenix pattern where you automate it, destroy it, automate it again, whether it's a server, container, or config.
Yep. Yeah, and that's also what I meant with ensure that it's also disposable. Another hype word, a disposable architecture, everything should be disposable because it doesn't matter what we used to have network IP plans and that kind of things, and that is carved in stone, and everyone should obey those IP plans in the on-prem world. And now you have a network infrastructure only focused for that part, and that is disposable, that can be thrown away and can be recreated without issues if you have that different mindset. So that's ensuring that everyone understands that there is a difference helps everyone. And monitoring is a really important part of that. There's a part is real-time visibility, data, and maybe the silliest one that people forget and companies forget is allocation. But that cost allocation is, for example, is it this application for that department or or other way around for that client?
Even but more tricky is this. If you use like a firewall for your whole company, how do you cost allocate that service? Yeah, but you're gonna spend, okay, that's a high usage application, so it needs to contribute more towards that service, or how are you going to do that?
And we have not a total solution of all that. However, in the beginning of the presentation, we mentioned something about a term that you say we will get back to later on. Anyone who knows what that name was? No? Let me get a picture. Zero user costs.
So anybody already maybe know what we mean by zero user cost? Imagine a store. You have like a proper building. You have all the shelves in place. All the stock is there.
Like an Albert Heijn or Delhaize or whatever.
Yep. Registries open. The lights running. You've got the heating system on. Neon lights on the building.
Oh yeah, and those people, I'm not sure what the English word is, but the people who are restocking everything, they are ready to restock everything.
Yeah. You can calculate how much that will cost you without any users. The same is with the cloud. So zero user cost is take away all your users from the system. How much are you paying at that moment?
And then
apply all the users again on the system. How much are you paying at that moment?
Because that, if you combine that, then you have the cost without a single user, and you know what 100 users cost, or one user cost.
Yeah, and the trick is if you don't see any change in that number, you start, there's something wrong with your architecture. Yeah.
Yes.
So, and the trick is, you want as low as possible fixed costs,
yes.
And then start apply. If there's more users, you start spending more.
Base cost.
Yep.
So, and what we tend to, what this is also good to be tracking, because if you, and in a different presentation, we have beautiful graphs. If you have a linear graph of costs, let's say for a month. They already know you have a bad system, because if you're paying the same amount each day,
then of no one is using it,
yeah.
Or everyone is using it, but that's not really possible. If it's a straight line or straight, and every day it's the same price, then probably the price ain't right, or your architecture ain't right.
So the holy grail would be zero users, would be 0 euros of usage.
Cost,
matter of fact, yeah, that's not possible because you need to have some certain infrastructure in place for when the users are there. But lowering your zero user cost is probably the best way to reduce overall spending. So, and how do you do that?
One of the things that you can do, and you can look at that, but you can also just this because that's not exactly the same. One of the things that you can do, if, for example, that firewall that Twan just mentioned for the whole company, that would be really difficult to allocate a bit for that application or that application. So segmentation is one of those patterns that you can use to get those costs together and afterwards have a number that can divide the shared cost or whatsoever. So you have to think of patterns like multi-tenancy. You have to get give insights, transparency. Come back to that later, and also just check the bill. And that's a simple one.
Yeah. Who here is using the cloud? I think all. Yeah.
Who from all of you who are using the cloud have checked the bill?
Ah, oh, nice.
Awesome.
We have presentations where people say I don't have access to that page, and then that's fun because then you just start using stuff and you don't know how much you're spending.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it can also get some interesting thoughts because then you can be already bankrupt before.
You already know. So And that's why I'm going to skip some.
Yeah,
the team excellence is really important. This is this part. I really like this because this is the typical developer, I think.
And you see it, everyone is watching the Kubernetes. Some people are checking the policies.
Yeah, policies is like drowning. Okay, don't deploy this or don't use this. And then the budget is like, well, I'm not paying those bills, so I don't care.
In practical way, a lot of people are really not using budget anymore since, let's say after a year or 2 years are using the cloud, especially in huge enterprise organization, make that, in my opinion, bad decision, because they think, it will manage itself. But if you give them insights.
There's a lot of studies done, and we also have at our company, we have company cars, and when they go to the garage for maintenance, we get sent an email with the total bill of that maintenance. We don't need to pay that, but it's just a reminder for people to say, well, we as a company spent this amount on the maintenance, and that helped reduce the overall maintenance cost by 30%. Just by making people aware of how much is being spent.
So no budgeting or hard cuts or saying you are not allowed anymore, but just giving an email, so adding an email to the routine that every team can have some ownership and making someone kept in cash and give them that insight of the cash flow of that Azure subscription, of cloud subscription, and making them aware will automatically, just by awareness, decrease, at least for some people and some environments, decrease the cost.
If you are being really blunt, you can say it's a sort of gamification with your company's money, but just showing the number of euros or dollars spent a month on a dashboard, like on the floor where your team is, that helps reducing.
And you don't have to make it like it should be this reduction created or whatsoever. Just giving insights
helps. It helps you in the mindset when you are thinking for a new solution or fix. It's also that you look at it from your corner of the eye, you see the dashboard with like the dollar or the euros, and you're like, oh, maybe I can pick a smaller size. Do I really need the biggest SKU in Azure? And for me, a complete DevOps team needs a Captain Cash, somebody who is responsible for the spending, making sure we pick the right solution, the most cost-efficient solution.
And that's like a role for, let's say that person has once each quarter checks as Mr. Cash, what happened the last quarter? That can be enough, right? I mean, just give someone that responsibility of cloud cash.
And in terms of time, I already got the 5 minutes. That combines like all the three areas we have.
So create a good architecture, of course, with principles and everything that you know. Stay learning and continue improvement. Don't forget the involvement of the team. That's really important. It's on the slide, so I'm going to touch a bit on technically, bigger is not always better. When it comes to Azure environment, if you have a big application or big service plans, most of the time that's not really manageable and therefore is maybe not better in pricing perspective, and also bigger is often non-manageable, so that's why the performance is also not better.
We're building microserver architecture for our software, why not for our cloud? So why do we need those big environments or super subscriptions? Just make them smaller, so it's more manageable for everybody. Thank you for being here and listening to us. If you want,
I clicked wrong.
If you want to connect, you can scan one of these. You go to our LinkedIn page. It's not something funny or a meme. If you want to see something else, we'll be speaking on all these events.
Yeah, I did want to click.
No, just...
Yeah, awesome. I worked hard on the PowerPoint presentation.
Do we have time for any questions? I'm looking at...
Yeah, awesome. Any questions? Any
questions, please ask or... Yeah. So, what should be there is the who created it, which department, what's the purpose. It's also depending, because I have this discussion a lot, and then I've come to the conclusion that it's depending on the company, because some companies are inherently designed based on product. You got somebody who's based on different departments with different products. So that's...
Yeah, but
It should mirror like the company's organization.
But I like the disposable part, so I always like the tagging of can be deleted after or expires after, and then a script that just removes a whole subscription or a whole resource group or a whole set of resources. That disposable and tagging that on that way already, that helps.
If you want to be really fancy, you can say that just delete every development environment at midnight.
Yeah, that's
the pattern. Yeah. And don't do auto spin up. Just when somebody logs in, it comes back online.
And we have seen those ridiculous thing as auto spin ups, but not auto shutdowns. It's the same situation, which a person didn't touch the whole environment for 6 months, and I could buy a house for that money that was...
See, question.
Have you seen other tools to find the ways to tell? I used like Cloud and things like that, but they don't show you really that unused resources or
resources that doesn't get the... So, if I understand correctly, does the cloud show you the underused...
No, have you seen any tools to find the
ways? Not... There are tools also within, and I'm also talking from an Azure perspective because that's what I know. There is a tool which is the advisory, which shows you like you have an underutilized system.
Yeah.
It that works. It's rule based, nothing fancy AI like, or it doesn't. It just looks at CPU utilization and then says, well, it's on average, it's below 5%. Maybe you should shut it down. Maybe you should decrease the size.
And at the same time, but tool cannot really determine what is the application for. So if the application is used from CPU perspective, but from end user perspective, no one is using it. That you cannot always track that. And there are really smart external applications who can get more insights of your environment. But Azure default set does a pretty good job for the default things like underutilized CPU, underutilized memory, that kind of things.
If memory serves, I think Dynatrace is coming up with some solution to solve this. Because the not on that. Yeah.
No.
I think maybe with...
I
have high hopes for the Azure Copilot or the Azure Copilot one. It's currently in preview. They say it has access to all your Azure data. So if you ask him the question, which parts aren't being used...
It will be called Copilot. It will be Azure Copilot, and it's for management. And Microsoft is really focused on AI, just as the other big companies. So probably in that area will be a lot of improvement. Other tooling I cannot really come up with besides one approach, and that is visualize your cloud infrastructure and the connected parts. If you see orphaned standalone cloud things that are not used in the mix anymore, then they are probably disconnected in the application or whatsoever and can be also removed. That kind of visualization can help in also getting the old system and the old cloud elements away.
Any other questions, remarks?
No. Otherwise, come over here or send us a message. Thank you all.
Thanks.